social system and the evolutionary system. And today he's going to talk about the introducing physical constraints in modern sociales and biological evolution. Thanks for being here.
So today I'm going to talk a little bit about what I did in my PhD, during my PhD thesis, which was introducing physical constraints in models of social and biological evolution. And so just a short summary on why I did study this kind of issue. Actually, in most models of social and biological evolution, there is like a very big thought on, okay, we have to focus on what happens with temporal and spatial correlations and all of these things, but most models forget the fact that there is a limited amount of resources in the environment, in any ecosystem, even in the universe. It can be a huge amount, but it's limited. So I concerned a little bit of what happens when we take into account this limitation of resources, even if we forget about the fact that there is a spatial correlations and all these things. What's the effect of this limitation of resources? So I'm gonna start the talk making a short introduction of the concepts. I'm pretty sure that most of you already are familiar with all these concepts of cooperation, resource dilemma, and all these things. But I'm gonna make, anyway, a short introduction, which is always good. Then I'm gonna talk about this part that I was presenting, what happens in a world with finite resources. There's a limited amount of resources. Anywhere you can look. And so how does that influence the evolution of cooperation? Is that the law for cooperation have to evolve or not? Then, in a third part, I'm going to talk as destruction as a source of regeneration. So how do destructive behaviors that destroy public goods, how does that affect the evolution of cooperative behaviors for that reason? And at the end, I will present the conclusions. So first, introduction. Where does the theory that I'm going to talk, that I'm going to use for this presentation, where does it come from? What's the reasoning that allowed us to come here? So around the 1850, 1859, Darwin and Wallace, more or less at the same time, they were presenting the theory of natural selection, which you already know, this process of mutation, selection of new individuals, selection of the fittest individuals, and all supposedly all the features that we can observe in nature come from this kind of process over a long time periods. And both of them, they were actually influenced by the ideas of Malthus. Malthus was saying, okay, in human societies we have an increase in the resources that we are producing, which is linear, and the population is increasing geometrically. So actually what happens is that now we have a lot of resources, but there will be a moment in which resources will become limiting. So there will be a problem and people will start fighting for those resources. So Darwin and Wallace actually thought, okay, if this is happening in human societies, it's also happening in nature. So there is a struggle for the existence, but this struggle for the existence is also a struggle for resources. Actually, Kropotkin in the 1900s said, well, actually this is true, but it's not totally true, because I have been traveling around Siberia and other places, and what I have seen is that when the environment is very bad or is not supporting life, actually individuals are cooperating to survive. So individuals are not always in a struggle for life. They are also, there is also what he said, mutual aid. And he also proposed that it was kind of an important factor for the evolution. Actually, after that, the discovery of the genes and of the DNA made all the biologists forget a little bit about the problem of the resources, and everyone started focusing on what happens with the genes. And so, in the 1930s, population genetics was developed by Haldane and other people, and Hamilton, this guy here, developed gene selection theory within this population genetics. And what he said was actually that if there was enough relatedness in between individuals, as to say, if you are cooperating or interacting with people who are from your family or close relatives, altruistic behaviors, cooperative behaviors, may evolve without any other need but this genetic relatedness. It was generalized by Price a little bit later. He did what is called covariance analysis, and this covariance analysis just tells you what is the statistical structure that allows for cooperative behaviors to evolve. It doesn't matter if the correlation is due to some kind of relatedness or it's any other kind. This analysis tells you in which kind of situations altruistic behaviors may just evolve, even if these altruistic behaviors shouldn't evolve because they are giving benefits to other individuals and not to oneself. So, a little bit before Nash started developing his PhD thesis, what is now called the game theory, which is actually a mathematical theory to explain how interactions in between individuals can be modeled and what happens with this, what the results of these interactions. But this is a static theory, and Maynard Smith, together with Price, generalized this theory in the 1974 or around to make it. To put it into an evolutionary context. So now, it's not just studying what happens when you make the statistics of the population and the interactions, but you can actually model what happens with direct interactions in between individuals in a very accurate way, and in cladding of the evolutionary process. What happens here? When they started looking, using this theory, they forgot completely also what happened with the limitation of resources, which had somehow been taken into account one century before. So after that, in the last 10, 20 years, many lots of studies have focused on what happens with cooperation and altruism when you are into a context in which you have some kind of a space or networks, but there's nothing about what happens with the resources. Why is important cooperation? I'm pretty sure that maybe I'm making a long introduction, but I think it's good to remember the concept. So cooperation is necessary, or is supposed to be important, very important for the higher, or for the creation, or for the emergence of higher order structures. So these higher order structures, the typical example, which is maybe the one that I'm going to talk about mostly today, it's the emergence of multicellular life. So what happens when you have a lot of individuals who are cooperating and they are creating some kind of higher order structure? Cells actually have undergone this transition when multicellularity appeared. But cooperation is also important for all the other transitions that, for instance, from solitary individuals to colonies, or even from primate societies to human societies. So what is cooperation? Because I'm talking about cooperation, and everyone has some kind of idea already in their heads of what cooperation is. But what is it exactly? The definition of cooperation, the most extended definition, is that cooperation is the action or process of working together towards the same thing. Some people gather together, they want to make something, and they somehow share the work in order to do that. In a biological context, what is required is that the result of the interaction, to be cooperative, it has to be good in some appropriate sense. This goodness, it could be said that it's in a biological, in a Darwinian way, so it could be in the fitness way. So cooperation, somehow when individuals are cooperating, they are going to have a higher reproductive capacity. That's the fitness.
So this definition,
yes,
say that cooperation between two individuals, cooperation, as it is considered in game theory, is not considered.
It actually is.
What is the collective action? What is the collective action?
Well, actually, when two individuals are interacting, if both cooperate, the collective action would be the result. It's like, that's what it says.
But what talks about collective one implies
many? Yes, but actually, collective, it can be two. It just requires more than one collective. So interaction requires two.
A very mathematical answer.
It's a very mathematical answer, but it's... yeah, actually, there's a lot of debate in this case. Actually, I'm going to talk a little bit about that later. Because actually, one can have a cooperative behavior, and that doesn't require collective action. You can behave cooperatively without the need of any other individual working with you. But for cooperation, for what is cooperation, not cooperative behavior, you need, you require, it's required to have some kind of collective.
What I mean is that in the game theory set up the problem of cooperation originally, you only consider a problem of two individuals.
Yes.
In a normal sense, this is not collective function.
Well, I would say that collective already.
Yeah, okay, more than one is collective. More than one is many body. Okay.
So, cooperation can be found in all levels of biological evolution. Actually, you can find it even in viruses who cooperate or not to parasitize host cells. You can find it also in bacteria who cooperate or not in order to process externally food that they digest it externally and then they internalize it. You can find it also in cooperative hunting, for instance, or cooperative defense against hunters. Or you can find it in humans, for instance, to build towers or to create social groups, any kind of social group. So what's the two main features?
But your last picture was a failure.
Yeah, actually it was a failure of cooperation. I will talk about that later. It was supposed to be a failure of cooperation, but induced by someone who didn't want the people to cooperate somehow. So there are two main features of cooperation. One is that groups of cooperators perform better than groups in which not everyone is cooperating. So it's supposed that if everyone is cooperating, the result is the best one that you can get. And it's more beneficial to interact with individuals who are behaving cooperatively. That's to say, if someone is giving things to the others or creating some social good on himself, just by himself, and all the rest can choose to interact with this individual or with someone who is not creating any kind of social good, it's clear that the cooperative behavior is going to be more beneficial for those interacting with him. So, when you model cooperation for direct interactions, so there is one individual, and this is just from the behavioral point of view, so no more collective action, just you look to one individual, you focus on what he's doing, he's somehow creating an effect on himself, this would be a cost for the actor, and this here would be a benefit, a direct benefit for the actor from his own action. And he's interacting with someone and he can produce a positive effect on the other ones or a negative effect. When you look to this classification of behaviors, of what happens when someone is creating this kind of benefit or not, you can classify behaviors as altruistic. So that means you are paying some kind of cost to give a benefit to another individual. There is mutual benefit. In this case, from your action, you benefit from your own action, but you also produce a benefit on the others. There is spite, which is also an evolutionary common ground, but I'm not going to talk about that today. That's when it's bad for you, but you are also creating bad for the others. And there is also parasitism. That's when it's good for you, and you are somehow producing a cost on the others. Everyone, the classification, everyone knows the problem of altruism against free riding. Free riding would be this null point here. So individuals producing a benefit on the others at a cost to themselves, when they interact with individuals who are not producing any kind of effect on the others, they just have the cost and they just get the benefits to the others. But parasitism, actually, parasitic individuals, when they interact with free riders, they also produce a prisoner dilemma, which has not been so much studied. And this prisoner dilemma has similar features or practically the same ones as the altruistic dilemma. But now the cooperative individual is the individual who is free riding, who is not producing any kind of benefit or doesn't imply any cost to himself. Because parasites are actually the bad individuals here, we could say, but in the sense that it's more selfish and less cooperative.
Excuse me, this direct fitness?
Direct fitness effects. That's actually when you take the payoff matrix of the prisoner's dilemma, it's usually assumed.
So, but how do you define fitness in this context?
Fitness, yes, it's true. I didn't define it because I'm. So fitness, it's just the measurement of the reproductive capacity of the individuals. So
that's, I mean, you're making an analogy here with the prisoner's dilemma, but I think that's not the
I'm going to talk now about the prisoner's dilemma, but yes, actually any kind of altruistic behavior in this
prisoner's dilemma, there is no mention of reproduction.
No, but when you take the payoff matrix, you use it to allow for reproduction later, usually. In the prisoner dilemma, not, but in the evolutionary prisoner dilemma, you translate this payoff, the payoffs of the payoff matrix, into reproductive capacity. So that individuals with higher payoff somehow will have a higher, will spread their genes or their behaviors to the next generation. I'm going to go into that now. So this is just to make clear the classification of behaviors and to make clear that there is not only altruism and neutral individuals, but parasites and neutral individuals produce the same kind of interactions. So as I was saying, that could be measured as fitness, but it could be, this classification is general, whether this is fitness or whether you are taking as a measurement any other thing. Any other thing. I just put it here, fitness, because it's the context that I'm going to talk about now. So, as I said, there are two ways to define a prisoner's dilemma. I'm going to just define it very quick, because I'm pretty sure that everyone already knows it, but the thing is that when you have cooperative individuals, in this case altruists, and you have defective individuals, in this case free riders, if you make a classification on, of all the possible interactions, so for the row here, you have the focal individual. So what happens when a cooperative individual interacts with another cooperative individual? As both of them are altruists, both of them pay the cost, and both of them receive the benefit from the other individual. The net payoff for a cooperative individual is the benefit minus the cost. If a free rider interacts with a cooperative individual, in this case, he's not paying any cost and he's not giving any benefit to the other individual, but he is receiving the benefit. So he gets net payoff, which is the benefit, and that's all. Two free riders interacting together, none of them pays the cost, none of them gets the benefit, it's zero. And the cooperative interacting with the defective individual, he pays the cost, he doesn't get the benefit back. What happens here? If you're interacting with a cooperative individual, if you're cooperating, you get B minus C, the benefit minus the cost, but if you turn not to cooperate, you would just get the benefit. So you would increase your payoff as you're not paying the cost. It happens exactly the same if you are interacting with a defector. If you're interacting with a defector and you are cooperating, you pay the cost. If you decide not to cooperate, you just keep paying the cost. So in this kind of dilemma, this is why it's called the prisoner's dilemma, cooperating gives the best benefit, that gives the benefit minus the cost. It's better if everyone is cooperating, because everyone is going to get this net payoff, which is positive, assumed to be positive. While if everyone is not cooperating, everyone is just not going to get any kind of benefit. But in any interaction, it's better if you turn from cooperating to not cooperating, irrespective of with whoever strategy you are playing with. This is what defines the tragedy of the commons. If we assume that we are in an evolutionary context, that individuals were increasing, maximizing their payoffs, they are spreading in the population, somehow at the end, everyone is going to end up not cooperating and with a payoff of zero, instead of the positive benefit of everyone cooperating. Exactly the same kind of dilemma. This is because the most usual prisoner's dilemma, but exactly the same kind of dilemma happens if you take passive free riders as the cooperators and parasites who pay a cost and steal a benefit. You mix both of them, you have the same kind of prisoner's dilemma. So this was just the introduction. Maybe it was a little bit long, but I wanted just the concept to be a little bit explain a little bit more than people who are not working with it usually know. But now let's see what happens again with the why this study. Why? Most studies, as I said, assume up to now that in this prisoner's dilemma there is a finite population or an infinite population, but the payoffs do not depend or are not correlated. Most studies within an evolutionary and theoretical framework, I have to say, because biologists in some frameworks are working with studies in which they take into account the limitation of resources, but they took it into account much more during the 1900s and the beginnings of the last century than in the last 50, 60 years. So what happens when we put this limitation of resources into the evolutionary models of the prisoner's dilemma that I just explained? So after that I will go into the discussion of common goods, but now, what happens with this? There is a world of finite resources. In this world, we can use resources to produce social goods as well as to survive. And how does that limitation of resources influence the evolution of cooperation? So if we look to the Earth or to an ecosystem, what we have as a general representation, as a very schematic representation, is that there is a flow of energy into the system. I'm going to talk about energy, but energy or resources, okay? There's a flow of energy out of the system. That's just because we assume that the system is in equilibrium. There are no systems that grow forever and ever. And there are natural resources which are in the environment. So somehow life on Earth could be seen as a steady state of equilibrium in this flux of resources. So in order to study how the energetic restriction...
Why steady state?
Because actually this flow of resources is already implementing...
Do you really believe that now planet Earth is in a steady state?
Well, we could say maybe it's not exactly on a steady state, but it's not oscillating chaotically, exploring a lot of possibilities. And actually, if it's not on a steady state, actually we could say that in the short time scale, we could assume that it's on a steady state. It's not changing regularly.
Do you think that our society is in a steady state?
No, our society, I wouldn't say that it's in a steady state. Sure. But that's the other part at the end where I'm going to talk about destruction. I'm going to talk a little bit about the cycles of society. But I think that this is, of course, a very, very, very huge oversimplification, right? It's just an oversimplification to try to extract how the limitation of resources allows for cooperation.
It's just about the interpretation, wrong oversimplification.
Sorry?
It's a wrong starting point. Assume it will assume steady state.
Why?
Move around.
Yeah, but I mean,
now, which is the same, the market of this.
A steady state, by definition, a steady state is a steady state, is a state that you could somehow, you couldn't differentiate it from a stable state when you take a non infinite period of time, actually. So it depends on the time scale.
It's time independent, I would
say. Yes.
The state doesn't mean stationary.
Yes, but that's to make the analogy, because actually when I'm going to talk about that now, it's, as I said, this is an oversimplification in which I'm going to follow, maybe if you want, after two or three slides, you can stop again and tell me, but it's to make the analogy with models that physicists are more confident with. Okay, because actually when you talk with biologists, they will say for sure, well, actually nothing of this is true because you are not taking into account the genes. There are a million more behavioral types that you are actually taking into account. Resources come in 50 different ways and they don't interact in a linear way.
Well, so, we should not talk to them.
Yes, so I know this is a very limited model, but it's just to explain how this part of the entire thing, of the entire picture, makes the interactions. So there is going to be a macro scale, which is the resource influx and consumption, and the mesoscale in the model that I'm going to talk about, in which there is the internal dynamics, which is interactions of individuals and the process of natural selection. I'm going to skip the part of mutations, but I can tell you that the model behaves exactly the same with mutations, because I already did the simulations, but we didn't publish it and it's nowhere, so I'm not going to talk about it. But the results are really, it's not so important for the results. So, the model that we develop is a model in which individuals are unconditional cooperators and defectors. So, unconditional cooperators, they are just getting resources from the environment and they are using them for reproduction. Individuals, all of them reproduce when their resources go above a certain threshold. And defectors, they not only get the resources from the environment, but they can dissipate a certain amount of resources, which I'm going to call the cost, in order to parasitize resources from the other individuals. This is the benefit that they are getting from their parasitic action. Interactions are random. Deaths happen at random as well, totally independently of individuals being cooperators or not, and at the probability that I will vary. And the interactions with all these properties that I just said, The interactions define the prisoner's dilemma whenever resources are above a certain threshold. So, if individuals have enough resources, parasites can always pay the cost, and they can always get the benefit that they're expecting from the co-player they are interacting with. Whenever resources are below a certain threshold, parasites will not be able to pay the cost always, so they will pay just with a certain probability P, and they will not always get the resources benefit that they are expecting, because maybe the co-player doesn't have enough resources. So there will be an effective benefit that they are getting from the co-player.
So you have a finite probability, a finite population.
Yes, in this case we have a finite population, but it's given by, actually, as I said, there are resources which are coming, there is an influx of resources, and that determines the carrying capacity of the environment.
And when you see random interactions?
That's for the interactions in between individuals. When I implement the dynamics, I did computer simulations, so we just assume that individuals may interact with any other individual. In a time step, per time step, every individual interacts once.
So it is not that you have a random network of interactions?
No, it's in the mean field limit. It's, actually, we implemented this exactly to try to avoid any kind of interaction network effect on this situation. So we started, before doing the computer simulations, we started actually trying to analyze it with equations, so analytically. And what we have here is the equations for the evolution of the total amount of resources within the group of cooperative individuals and the total amount of resources within the group of defective individuals. Actually, if one of these two resources goes to zero, it means that that kind of group will extinguish with time because they don't have resources for reproduction. So, I'm not going to go into detail into the equations, but there is a term for the resources they are getting. It's the same for cooperators and defectors. There's a term for the deaths, the dissipation of resources according to deaths. And there is the interaction term. Okay, this interaction term is always negative for cooperators. Whenever they interact with defectors, they lose resources. Whenever they interact together, they don't have any kind of effect. So it's just negative due to the interaction with the defectors. And this term here depends on how much resources the other are spending or getting. So if there is a coexistence equilibrium, this is a hypothesis that we were just saying, okay, the prisoner's dilemma, the expected outcome is that cooperators will extinguish. Because actually, for the same reason as I was talking about the tragedy of the commons, they cannot get more resources than the co-players and the non-cooperative individuals. So, in this case, okay, let's assume that there is a coexistence equilibrium. This would be the condition for the coexistence equilibrium, that the net benefit should equal the resources that they are dissipating by the deaths. Okay, deaths occur at random, but maybe the mean amount of resources cooperators have is lower or higher than detectors. So if this happens, there's an equilibrium, and this can be proven to lead to a modified replicator equation. The replicator equation, I'm pretty sure that most people already know it. So this is the variation of temporal evolution for the fraction of cooperative individuals. It's the rho. And here we have a term which usually in the replicator equation depends on the payoffs. In this case, it also depends on the payoffs, but in the replicator equation with the prisoner's dilemma or a prisoner's dilemma, this is a constant term. And now this is not any longer a constant term, it's an nonlinear function dependent on resources. Okay? Just by the way we implemented the dynamics. So what happens? So,
sorry, I don't understand the notation, the bar over the EC and ED.
Actually, this that's just to say it's the mean amount of resources.
The mean on the
The mean of each individual. Yes, but it's not so important. Actually, I'm not going to use this anymore. It's just it's the mean amount of resources of defector of one defector and the mean amount per cooperator. Okay, this would be, it's the term that when there is one death, how many resources are dissipated by that death?
It's just a constant.
Well, actually, that depends on the distributions of resources. That's what I'm going to talk about now. If we want to solve, actually, this problem, we should know the distribution of resources within the population. We are actually distributing per time step the resources equally to every individual, just to avoid any kind of disturbance from the environment. But during the evolutionary process and due to the interactions, resources will take some kind of shape, and we don't know that in advance. That's coming from the dynamics of the system. That's a self-organizing process that happens within the system, and we cannot predict it in advance. So it would be somehow an analogy with, I always make that analogy, it's not exact, it's just an analogy, but if you look to the physics of the black body, this distribution would be the equivalent to the Planck equation for energy radiation. Without that equation, you cannot solve exactly what happens with the black body. Here, the same with the population. Without knowing this distribution of resources, we can't solve it. So actually, what we said was, okay, let's try some simplifying assumptions, and let's test these assumptions hold with computer simulations. So the assumptions were that there are many interactions per lifetime. So we assume that the probability to die, the F, was very low. We also assume a homogeneous distribution of resources. So okay, there will be some kind of distribution within the system. It could be any shape, but let's just assume by now that it's homogeneous. And we also assume that there is a feedback in between the resources that defectors are parasitizing and the fraction of cooperative individuals. Actually, that makes sense because the more cooperative individuals there are, the more resources that defectors can get from them. From that, it's easy to see. So if we make these three assumptions, we can get that there should be an equilibrium fraction of cooperative individuals, which should have this kind of shape. Well, this is the cost that defectors are paying. This is the benefit, that the maximum benefit that defectors can steal per interaction with from the co-player, and this is just a factor that depends on the threshold to reproduce. So that's just a normalizing factor. When you look to what happens with this equation that we did, the heuristic approach, if we represent in these triangles, in these graphics, we have here the net benefit that defectors can steal per interaction, and we have here the cost. Okay? So, when you look to this, if we represent in black a fraction of just cooperators, fraction of cooperators equal to 1, and in white, when the population is composed entirely by defectors, so a fraction of cooperators of 0, and there is a gray scale going in between both, according to the equation that I just showed you, according to the heuristic approach, this simplification, we have that there is a small region where defectors will be, at the end of the evolutionary process, the only one surviving. We have a region for, this is for very low cost for defecting, there is a region for higher costs where cooperators are the survivors, and there is a very big region of coexistence. Actually, we tested it with computer simulations. This is the same, but for the agent-based models. And what we found is that, okay, it's somehow interesting to see.
Let me understand it. The left thing is the solution of your equation.
Yes, this is from the equations. Mm-hmm.
And this is an agent-based model simulation of the same equations.
No, it's an agent-based model.
So why they should be different?
Well, actually, because here there are simplifying assumptions. Here we are not modeling the equations. We are modeling exactly the system as we defined it.
Okay, but the equations are mean field.
Yes, the equations are mean field and with some assumptions. Here.
Which assumptions? I mean, what is the difference?
Here,
not in the result, but
In the simulations we also have many interactions per lifetime because we tune that to zero, but the distribution of resources is not homogeneous. This is an assumption that we for obtaining the equation. So the distribution of resources.
What do you mean it's not homogeneous? Homogeneous in which space?
Actually, you can count when you put the simulations to work. You can look at some point to the histogram of how the resources are distributed within the simulation. For obtaining this here, we assume that this histogram was homogeneous just because we didn't know which kind of shape it would take in the simulations or in the real system. If you look to this, to that distribution here, it's never homogeneous. Actually, depending on the region you are, here, here, or here, it takes a decreasing exponential function. It can take some kind of bell shape. So Here, the main difference was that we assumed that this distribution was homogeneous just for analytical purposes, because actually, as we didn't have any kind of clue of how the system would be self-organized. So,
and system size?
In this case, 10,000 individuals in the population, but we tested it for different population sizes, and even with 100 individuals, the system behaves exactly the same. So it's not, if you don't go to populations very, very low, as to say 10, 20 individuals, nothing changes. I will show you later, I've got some graphics of that. So here, as I said, this is the system, what happens with the evolutionary process. There is this coexistence state, and why is this coexistence state important? If you look to the kind of games that the interactions may result in, for the prisoner dilemma that we have defined, defectors should win. That's the region of low cost. Defectors end up in the end being the 100% of the population. And for the harmony game, which is exactly the opposite as the prisoner's dilemma, cooperators are the ones which win the game. Actually, if you make the account on how the payoffs self-organize here, you can see, you can prove that it's a harmony game. But in all this region, the system self-organizes to that single point in the middle. Okay? It's not anymore a game. What happens is that the system is self-organizing, the interaction structure is organized, self-organizing this kind of resources distribution within the system, so that whenever the system goes by the oscillations, by the random noise, in any of the ways, it just turns out to the same place. So, in this case, the game becomes a neutral game, and coexistence is the evolutionary solution for all this range of parameters. If you look to the replicator dynamics, what happens is that the distribution of resources is self-organizing, so that this term goes to zero. And as that term goes to zero, there is no evolution when you are in the stable proportion with the proper fraction of cooperative individuals.
Is that a smooth transition from one region to the other?
Yes. Here it doesn't seem, but it's just because I could have put it, but it's the degradation of.
There are no critical points.
No. Actually, I will show you later. There's a transition, actually, when you change from all defection to coexistence. And there's a second transition when you turn from coexistence to a cooperation. Yes, there's a transition there, actually. But when you are in the coexistence region, it's just increasing smoothly. So there are, I will show you, I've got the analytical model later. So first, we just tried it if it was some kind of effect due to the distribution of resources, and we thought, okay, let's see what happens when you put an influx of resources into the system, which is varying with time. So we proved it, and actually we are representing here the fraction of cooperators in black. The oscillations are just due to the stochastic the stochasticity implied into the agent-based model. In blue, this is the number of individuals. As I said, the number of individuals is always following the influx of resources, because it has to follow the capacity, the carrying capacity of the environment. This is biologically, it's what happens in biological systems. You have a carrying capacity. If you increase the carrying capacity, population increases. It's the same that happens here. So we assume that there was a constant influx of resources into the system. As I said, there is always a stochasticity in every factor that we use for the simulations, but it's constant in a mean, as a mean. We introduce a sinus function for resources going into the system. The population started oscillating, but the mean continued being the same. So the fraction of cooperators is not dependent on having variable resource influxes or not. We also tested what happened with sudden transitions. So, okay, let's say that we have a population of around 10,000 individuals, and at some point, resources just decrease in a factor of 5. So you divide it abruptly. What happens is that during the time that the system, that the population is falling to the near equilibrium size, cooperative individuals increase, the fraction of cooperators increase a little bit. This could be seen as when we had this graphic before, the system goes into a harmony game. What happens in the opposite situation when you suddenly have a lot of resources more? You find a new source of resources. In that situation, parasitic individuals are highly promoted during the time span of population growth. Why? Because the system goes away from this neutral point and falls into a prisoner's dilemma. So, the question from before, are there transitions here? Actually, the transitions we're going to see now. We developed, as this system was kind of difficult to analyze analytically, as I said, there are some kind of non-linearities in the distributions of resources and everything. So we developed simplified models in which individuals are seen just to have resources or not have resources, so as if they were quantized. The defectors, they don't always have to pay the cost. They just dissipate the resources with a certain probability. All the rest is the same. I'm not going to go into the details, but all the rest is more the same as before. And actually what we found is that if we look especially here, we can see that there is a transition from a defective state to a coexistence state. Okay? This is one of the models. We actually tried other two simplifications, one in which resources are not only necessary for reproduction, they are also necessary for survival. And in that case, we have a region of defection, there's a region of coexistence, small one, and then there's a big region of cooperation as well. And if we assume that we have a constant population size, which is an assumption that in most evolutionary game theoretical models, not maybe not most of them, but many of them just assume a constant population size. What happens in that moment is that there's a region of defection, there's a region of coexistence, and here we are representing the attack probability to resource income ratio. That's the only one that I want to explain a little bit more in detail. So if this is the defector's cost, it's clear that the higher the cost the defector has to pay, the easier it is for cooperative individuals to survive. But as here we have the attack probability to resource income ratio, so this means that if you somehow reduce resources, you're actually moving from the point here, the resources are dividing here, so if you start here from a point here and you lower the amount of resources in the population, the system undergoes the transition towards coexistence. So this somehow tells you that if you have some kind of constant population size in a spatial portion of the ecosystem, you reduce the resources and it's easier for cooperative individuals to survive. So summarizing the results, we have seen that resources constraining group production allow for an internal self-organizing process in which the end is neutral coexistence, so the interactions in the end that do not matter for the evolutionary process. There's a neutral coexistence, then the fraction of cooperators and defectors will stay constant over time, the mean fraction, I say the average. And if you have constant population size, there's a resource group dependent phase transition to coexistence when you lower the resources. Do I have 5 minutes, 10 minutes? Yes. So this was the first part where I was studying my PhD thesis. The second part is destruction as a source of regeneration. What happens when you have not only cooperative and defective individuals, but individuals who are destroying common goods, irrespective of if they are created by cooperative individuals or by defective or whatever. So here we call it the Joker effect. Why the Joker effect? Actually, one day we were talking about the film, The Last Film of Batman. I don't know if you have seen it, but in this film there is this character, which is the Joker, and somehow this character is just going around burning the money from the mob, burning the money from the police, taking everything he can from anyone, and just doing nonsensical actions, but just to make the bad all around him. And what happens in the film is that there's a moment in which all the people that are convicts in the mob start cooperating with the policemen in order to try to stop this guy. So it must be the only moment in the film in which they are cooperating. So we thought of, actually, this is only because we like these kind of logical games that there are in the field, or this can happen also in biological context. So let's make a model, but actually before making the model we look on how the appearance of common enemies triggers cooperation. So Why Berlusconi? Actually, this is an example that I always say, because in Italian politics it's very clear that when Berlusconi is there, all the left parties, they just gather together and make like a common front to try to go against Berlusconi. But the two times that they got to the power through the elections, after they were in the power and they didn't have to take care anymore about Berlusconi, they just fragmented and the government fell down. So, it happens also in fish. Actually, you can see many fish which cooperate whenever there is some kind of potential danger around, but the rest of their lives, they are individuals, just solitary individuals. And it can be seen in other films, like I always like to put this example of The Princess Bride. There's a moment in this film, I recommend you if you haven't seen it, it's a very good one, in which the character, the main character, he's dead, and two friends, supposed to be friends of him, take him to a wither, to try to revive him. And the wither says, actually I don't want to revive him, I don't want to make him come back to life, because I'm pretty sure that you want him to be alive because he stole something from you and you want to get it back. And the guys tell him, no, actually we need him because it's for true love, because he has to marry his true love. He's actually looking for a girl in the field. And the guy says, no, actually I don't believe you, I don't believe you, this is not true. Who is that girl he wants to marry? And then the guys say, actually, this girl that he wants to marry is the bride of the king. And at that moment, the wizard said, the king, the bride of the king, that guy fired me 2 weeks ago, of course I will help him. You know, that's a typical example on how when you find the common enemy, there is always cooperation between. Anyway, we have also religion myths, we have history. And if you look, actually, whenever there is some kind of natural disaster or a war, after that, there is cooperation to try to restore the social goods and everything that was destroyed. And religion myths, you can find in many of them, actually, the process in which people are cooperating for making something good. At some point, they stop cooperating, and then God gets very angry and makes some kind of disaster, which is like punishing the population. In all these myths, there are cycles in which people cooperate, people stop cooperating just because someone will cooperate for them, and after that, destruction comes and people have to cooperate again in order to create the social benefits. We can also observe this in bacteria. There are bacteria, I'm not going to go into detail, but Escherichia coli, there is a kind of bacterial warfare in which there is a kind of Escherichia coli which produces toxins which kills all the others. And the others may cooperate or not in order to produce the antitoxins. So how can we model these kind of interactions? So now we are not talking just about one individual interacting with another. We are talking about groups. And we can say that cooperators in this group context, this is what we call public goods game. I'm sure most of you already know it. We have cooperators who pay the cost. This cost yields a benefit, which is higher than the cost, and which is redistributed within the group. There are defectors who do not pay the cost, but if they are within the group, they get the benefits as well, because they are equally shared. And now we have the jokers, which somehow they create the damage, which is redistributed in between any individual who is playing the game. It doesn't matter if it's a cooperator or a defector. We have a fitness function. This fitness function will be responsible for evolution again. And in this fitness function, we have introduced some selection strength, that it will be important later, just a selection strength, which measures how much of the payoff of the interactions, it doesn't measure how much, it measures the importance that the payoff of the interactions have in this evolutionary process. If we make this kind of representation, it's a schematic representation of the damage that jokers are producing, and the benefit, the multiplicative factor, we could say the benefit of the produced by cooperators, we can get to this space, and we have three different regions. In two of the regions, the damage jokers are producing is so high that all other individuals will extinguish, and there will be only jokers at the end. No one will produce any kind of social good. However, there's a region when the damage is not very high, and it fulfills this inequality here. In this region, there are cycles. So, jokers go to cooperators because cooperators can actually overcome, they can compensate the damage that jokers are producing. When everyone is cooperating, then defectors are spreading the population, as in the tragedy of the commons. And when everyone is defecting, jokers actually are producing so much damage that they are somehow driving the death of defectors. We use first the replicator dynamics just to test if these cycles happen for real.
So people switch between the cooperator and defector?
Yes. Well, actually.
And jokers?
Yes. We assume that these are three behavioral traits. And
is it a big population of everything?
Yes. There's a big population of everything. That's what I'm going to talk. That's what I'm going to tell you now. I'm going to explain.
No, I haven't seen these algorithms yet. Is that?
This actually is just a space to explain how the system behaves in any of these situations. And in this situation here, what happens is that according to the payoffs, okay, this here would be the benefit. If the benefit that cooperators are producing is enough as to compensate for the damage of jokers, it's what this inequality expresses here. So this benefit minus the cost, if we put that on the left, should compensate being with a group of jokers, then you are getting a higher benefit than the jokers. And if you are getting a higher benefit than the jokers, somehow in the evolutionary process, your trait, your behavior is going to increase.
The joker was not getting any benefit.
No, because he's not getting any benefit. He's just a null.
So what do you mean getting more than zero?
Yes, because actually the jokers are not participating in the game. They are just...
No, what I understand with the... People are turning from being defectors to being cooperators. That I can understand. And they turn from being defectors to being jokers?
Well, actually, what happens is that if everyone is defecting, no one is producing any benefit. Yes. But the jokers, they are still playing the public goods game. As they are playing the public goods game, they are being damaged by the jokers who are damaging public goods. So, defectors, when they play the game, they don't get any benefit, their payoff is null. Okay? But as jokers are producing a damage, their payoff is going below null. As jokers are not playing the game, they just stay on null. They have a higher payoff. It's not a benefit, it's just a higher payoff. It's zero against something negative. So the evolutionary process makes jokers increase, which are in the zero level.
I think that I also have it clear around, is the population fixed? Do you have a certain number of defector populators and jokers, or people are transforming from defector to their behavior?
There's an evolutionary process. You have a fixed population. In this case, we are not assuming variable populations, but the numbers of each one is changing according to the evolutionary process. That's an evolutionary process.
They are not changing. They are, some of them are dying and the others are producing faster.
Yes, but the replicator equation, many people assume that you can use it to represent bacterial populations who are reproducing and dying, but it's also, it has been used in social and cultural reproduction. In cultural reproduction, you could assume that it's a change of behavior. But I'm not going to go into those details because actually it's more philosophical reasoning. But well, so we have this region here when these cycles may happen, because actually if that happens, it could happen. And what we tested is with the replicator dynamics. In the replicator dynamics here, X is the proportion of cooperators, Y the proportion of defectors, Z the proportion of jokers. And this is the standard representation of the replicator dynamics with mutations which are not coupled with reproduction. But the results are the same. I didn't put the graphics here, but really with me it's the same. So we have here the payoff of cooperators, the mean payoff of the population, and here the term for mutations. This is the mutation rate. So what happens when we implement these dynamics is that we have limit cycles. In this region that I just showed you, we have a limit cycle, which is the attractor of the system. It doesn't matter in which kind of, with which kind of proportion of individuals you begin, you always end up here. Actually, this simplex, I'm assuming that you already know it, but this simplex is representing fractions of the population. In each of the corners, there is 100% of individuals, in this case of cooperators, here of detectors, and here of jokers. Every other point represents mixed populations. The center would be one third, one third, one third. In this axis, there would be just a mixture of cooperators and jokers. Irrespective of the initial conditions, you end up in this cycle. This cycle is a cycle that is very near in this point from all everyone detecting. In that point, it tends to go towards jokers, and when the fraction of defectors is low enough, cooperators start increasing the population. When cooperators have increased enough and there are no jokers, again, everyone goes to detection. This kind of evolutionary cycles, it can be proven that they happen for a lot, for a very big region of the parameter, in the parameter space, for many mutations, mutation rates. If mutation rates are very low, the cycles happen just from all cooperation to all defection to all jokers, as I represented before. When you go increasing the mutation rate, cycles start to decrease until they go to a fixed point, which it's now here, but when you put the very high mutation rates, it goes approaching one third, one third, one third. So, what happens? The replicatory equation usually assumes that there are very big populations. What happens when you look to populations, let's say, of 100 individuals? Actually, we can represent this with a Samoran process. There are other kind of processes, but Samoran process, it's the one that I'm representing here. And here, we are representing the evolution of strategy frequencies. In black, there is cooperators. In red, there is detectors. And in blue, there are jokers. As it can be observed, when time goes running, the same kind of cycles happen. Populations of cooperators are invaded by populations of defectors, and defectors by jokers. This all over time. We can actually also here make an analysis, stochastic analysis. We can find this master equation, and we can find the analytical prediction. So for the mean time that the system is going to be in each of the states. And what we find for this process is that we have for very low selection strengths, this means that the game is not very important for the evolutionary process, we have that cooperation takes about 50% of the time. Cooperative individuals are, all the population is composed by cooperative individuals 50% of the time. As the selection strength goes increasing, it happens that defection becomes the most probable state of the system. We tested this for many mutation rates. As I said, with the replicator dynamics happen that for low mutation rates, the most probable states are on the near the vertex and near the vertex and in the states in between. When you increase the cycle, starts decreasing and it goes to a fixed point, which would be there. But this before, what I was showing, sorry, I go back. What I was showing here, replicator dynamics are not stochastic dynamics. It's a deterministic system. In this case, we have probabilistic. It's just the probability of being in each of the states of the system, but it fulfills the same kind of properties. It has the same features of the deterministic system. So just to finish, why this might be important. Actually, in evolutionary game theory, there has been up to now a big focus on what happens on spatial distributions, and the focus on behavioral possibilities usually takes into account very complicated, not very complicated, but behaviors that need some kind of sensory input. As there's a lot of policing and punishment, for instance, it has been studied what happens when there is one individual who can punish another one for not cooperating, all these things. And the only simple behavior that was studied up to now, it's the so-called loner behavior, actually. Jokers, it's a very simple behavior. It doesn't discriminate anything. It just produces damage. And this damage could be interpreted not only as one behavior, But it could be interpreted as what happens when there is some kind of environment and that environment is producing a damage by itself. Actually, one could translate all these situations into a varying density of population, and the empty part of the population could be taken as a damaging environment, more or less. So the Joker is actually good alone for understanding what happens, to understand how to induce cycles or why cycles are induced in this kind of earthly or in ecosystems in which the ecosystems are not supporting life by themselves. So, just to finish, actually, this is just, I don't think it's very important by now, because no one has tested this, but there are some studies, clinical studies, that try to apply this kind of reasoning to tumor growth and trying to understand the treatments for the cancer as a damage. And this could also be used to make predictions within this framework, to try to make some predictions on how the system is going to react when you start applying this kind of treatments. Well, I'm not going to go more into detail because I think I already took a lot of time. Thank you very much for inviting me. Just present you the people I was working with. This is Juan Camacho from the Universidad de Autónoma. I developed all the part of the resources with him and also the Joker. And Alex Hermes and Jose Cuesta, I developed the part of the Joker with them. And here is the publications we already have, just in case you are interested. And thank you very much.
Well, we have already some questions. Any other? Anyone?
The first part of your talk, you introduced the influence of a sudden decrease of resources. Mm-hmm. According to your model, the level of cooperation should go up. If you apply that, for example, to the financial crisis here in Spain, where we had a sudden decrease of resources, it's statistically proven that the gain, the benefits of defectors has gone up while the common gain has gone down. What is missing in your model?
Who has proved this?
Well, it's proven that the benefits of the riches has gone significantly up, and it's clear that the benefits of the common good have gone.
The economic model is actually, when I'm talking here, when I'm modeling this system, where is it? When I'm modeling the system and we have this here, what we have is a decrease in the number of individuals. And in the financial crisis, there has just been a redistribution of resources, no increase or decrease of individuals. At least
it's
some kind of
result. What you showed here. I'm just asking,
the thing is that if we made this kind of thing from before, thing is that when you talk about resources and when we are talking about the behavior, we are economists usually assume that you can classify behaviors according to how much money they are spending or not. Actually, behaviors should be classified according to how people are cooperating or not. Maybe the financial crisis has gone to a redistribution of resources, but actually people didn't stop cooperating. Actually, I think that people are cooperating much more now. They have less money, but they are making this Banco de Alimentos, I don't know how to call that. Now they are gathering food for people who cannot pay for that. So actually, cooperation has somehow increased. But it's not translated into economical terms.
But it might be that, for example, what I was actually expecting from you, that you would say, okay, what is not considered there, that the benefits and the costs might also vary in time, depending on the parameter dependent on the resources.
Yeah, that's
and that's, for example, that is not considered in this model.
Yeah, but as I told you, the main difference why I wouldn't apply this kind of model right now to the economic crisis is because here we are assuming that population size is following. It's more like what happens in ecosystems, so animals, not humans. There is a decrease in resources and there are massive extinctions. Actually, money is not something that is going to make you die. It could potentially. but it's not what it said.
Basically, I mean, the set that would fit better to what you are thinking now is the one you have the population constant and you reduce the influx of sources.
Yes, that would be much more.
You saw some of the diagrams of what happened in those situations. So, but for example, if you didn't saw in those diagrams, was it's the distribution of the source per individual, and maybe changing this diagram. And this can explain something that happens with the crisis, the yeah. Distribution.
It would be more, but that's the point. Actually, I'm not representing here the distribution of resources within individuals. Actually, if we look to the distribution of resources, it could happen. I didn't test it because, actually, I will test it now that you have taken this idea, because it seems interesting.
Either in the mobile, even less than hand.
Yeah, but it would be, actually, maybe here the distribution of resources is more split than there is when there are all the defectors. When there are all the defectors, the distribution is probably going to be very much homogeneous. Maybe here there is also some kind of distribution which is not equally for all of them, but there is no system.
We don't have only consider here the binary set, no? So there is cooperation and defection in these kind of sets, but is there any way to do a mixing? Like an individual can take more than one action or not. But if you can introduce mixed strategies in these models?
Yeah, it could be introduced. Actually, we didn't introduce it here because we just wanted to test the minimal model for it. But yeah, it would be. Actually, we thought about what would happen if individuals could have this kind of mixed strategies or some kind of input of the resources that are in the environment and react to that. So we were thinking about it. But this was just the best for the moment. So.
There is one of the important aspects when you change from the deterministic equations to the stochastic ones is the effect of extinctions. For example, if you try to apply this to bacteria and treatments and these kind of things, drugs may try to reduce to make the population to be zero.
Yes.
And then there is no possibility of cycles because some species are extinct cannot recover. I am surprised in some of the stochastic experiments to say when there is no mutation that you go very, very close to the extinctions, to pure populations, but you have not commented on extinctions. Are some parts of the parameter space?
Yeah, actually I didn't comment on extinctions because the thing is that even if it's very low, when there is any kind of mutation, these cycles happen. Of course, if mutations go to zero, completely zero, whenever the system goes to one of the corners, it just stays there. That's going to happen. But this would be better seen here. Show you when you have all the probability for very low mutations, you can see that actually you cannot see it because the resolution is not very good, but actually the three corners are much more stable, are practically blue, okay, and the rest of the system is just in medium, so these transitions over here. If you go to zero, the transition that goes first, it will just fixate and it will finish the system. What's the problem with applying this kind of concept to cancer and treatments and everything? One has to have very clear who are the cooperators and who are the defectors. And I have been to some talks given by people who are making research in laboratories or experimental or testing drugs and everything. And what they are realizing, they are like changing their minds, because somehow it seems that what they thought that they were the cooperative cells are not, and what they thought that they were the defective cells are not. And it's somehow a little bit mixed. And not only that, but when they are applying the treatments, actually, what they are getting as a result in many situations is that they are killing only the weakest of the cancer cells, but the strongest are surviving, and the system is fixating into a cancer that they cannot kill. So actually, I'm not saying that this is going to solve any kind of problem, but making this modeling could allow to try to understand that maybe what you have to do is not trying to kill all the individuals and put them there. Because if the cycle is going to make like that, maybe what you want to make is induce, sorry, make like that, maybe what you want to make is induce the cycle starting by here, and then when the system goes up by itself, trying to fixate it there. This is what I'm saying, because now some people who are making medical research are thinking all these things. Maybe just going straight is not the way. Maybe we have to make something taking into account the properties of the system. So, that was.
Well,
thank you.
What is not clear to me is in what sense the dynamics of this system is replicated. Where is the part that one that it came from the effect of cooperative and jokers? Or where is that in the system? What this is not just three species evolving or typical rules of three alternating majorities taking place in mutation? What is the ingredient that this tells that this is that thing?
Well, actually, the point is that as we are just simplifying it to this kind of very simple behaviors, it could apply to very different.
So this could be Coca-Cola, Pepsi-Cola, and gas, for example?
Yeah, it could represent it, but it could
represent so it. It. Actually, it so is just, that's my question. If it is so generic, then what is the prediction?
Well, the point is that we have shown with this very simple model that this kind of cycles may happen.
Yeah.
Because actually no other model proved this before.
But so log cycles and paper that the game is cyclic.
Yes, that's a game which is cyclic, first because you are assuming, okay, let's create a cyclic model. Actually here we are not creating a cyclic model, we are looking to which kind of part of the
and you put a game that has three ingredients with parameters, and then you look at which parameter there is something. My point is that what is the ingredient that tells you that this is the right situation to reproduce a given behavior, or why the game, why this should be written in this form, or why the dynamics are these ones? Replicator with three variables should be cycled. Now, why this is
not right? The point is that the replicator with three. That's, I'm sorry that up to now, from simple behaviors, whenever there were three behavioral types, usually from simple behaviors I'm talking, they talked about cooperators, non-cooperators, and loners. It's the only third simple behavior that people have taken into account. And with the loners, cycles do not happen when you put mutations into the system. So this was proof that it's possible to have this kind of system when you put the mutations which had not been proven before. With simple behaviors. With other kinds of behaviors, it has been proven that it could be this cyclic behavior. But it was more to prove this situation. Also, of course, if you have three behaviors and there are cycles, it's going to be a rock, paper, scissors. There is no other way. That's true. But it will be true for any system that you find cycles and there are three behaviors, it will be rock, paper, scissors. That's mathematical truth. That's it. It is. But we were not designing the system for that. We were just trying to prove that, well, actually we didn't try to prove it, we just found it. But we were trying to see what happens when you have destructive system, destructive behaviors, which are not directed, because actually biologists, not only biologists, but sociologists and people working in this kind of dilemmas, took into account what happens when there is policing, when there is punishing, but directed punishing against defectors and all these things, and things like this happen. But so, just by some kind of destructive behavior around happening this, no one knew it before. I'm not saying it could be applied or not. I think, and I hope, it could be applied. But we just proved that this kind of simple thing allows for the rock, paper, scissors to happen in a situation in which no one expected it.
Okay, we spend a little bit. You can talk a little more to me now. Well, thanks again.